hey everybody, we had a great question come in about dancing and I want to jump right into it. Josh wrote in and he said, at the Brooklyn Folk Festival, there was a woman named Jane who danced to your song. May I ask what genre of dancing was that? I thought it was Irish, but I was wrong. So Josh, thanks for that question. You're close. I guess, you know, Josh, maybe you were at the festival. I guess you must, that's how you saw it. But Jane is somebody, I bump into her occasionally up there. She's been in the old time music circle for a long time and teaching dancing and I guess dancing around for years and years. And she's a good dancer. And so when I see her up there, she likes to come on stage and sort of, you know, well, demonstrate the dancing and try to get at least kids and stuff to see and be interested. And encourage if people know how to dance, because this sucker is a dancing instrument, right? So that's why I'll have Jane come on for one or two songs usually. So the style of dancing is sort of Irish. If you've seen the folk, traditional folk Irish dancing, sort of, I guess, jig dancing, you might call it. Like people think of river dance. They call it river dancing now because of that damn show that traveled all over the world, the River Dance Show. But what they were doing in that show was the old traditional Irish folk dancing, which I guess they called jig dancing. And we can trace what Jane is doing is not quite that, because, you know, it's a very American style that she's doing there. What I would call that is flat foot dancing. If you notice, mostly her feet when she's dancing are mostly shuffling around, and she's doing a lot of heel and toe and shifty stuff like this with her feet, but her feet are mostly kind of staying flat, level, hovering close to the ground. So that's why that style sort of started to glean the name of flat foot dancing. But it's also hoedown, buck dancing, they call it. People will call it clogging. Clogging is usually applied to more northern and western styles of dancing where the feet are kicked up a lot more high steps. Your knees come up a lot higher. Usually clog dancers will bring their knees up high and fling their feet around more. But an Eastern Appalachian flatfoot dancer like Jane Henderson is her name, mostly keep their feet flat, keep their body pretty erect, pretty rigid body for the most part. Your hands kind of do whatever they want, but the feet are kind of going around. That basic step where she's kind of walking forward and shimmying backward, that's just the basic walking step, the Tennessee walking step, the hoedown step, square dance step, standard step that you're doing there. And people do that all up and down the East Coast. I've seen people in Canada do that same dance, and I've seen people down in Florida do the same dance all over the East Coast. And then you get out west is where you see more of the maybe the buck dancing and stuff, although they do buck dancing all over the East Coast too. So there is a strong Irish influence, obviously, and to the best of my knowledge, when I can figure that style of dancing, I've always kind of figured it's a melding of Scots-Irish, British, maybe, and French and German, you know, jig dancing from Europe mixed with Native American and African American dancing. I think that's pretty obvious when you see some of it, and you see that you can see in traditional Native circles, there are people that square dance that same way. And you go into the traditional Black music, whatever's, you know, left of either of these communities, people, they dance that way. And I've seen, of course, tons of it, of mostly white people in Western North Carolina, Western Virginia, East Tennessee. Lots of people still know how to do that style of dancing. So if you're interested in that, you can look up flat foot dancing, buck dancing, traditional square dancing, that kind of thing, hoedown dancing. And a lot of the music that I play, a lot of these banjo tunes I play, I'll call it a hoedown number or a square dance number, because that's what it was for. If you guys want to get, you know, since I am reading this really good book by Dana Epstein, Sinful Tunes and Spirituals. It's all about Black folk music from the earliest colonial days in the 1600s up to the time of the Civil War. And she talks a lot about dancing in here. And we can see some descriptions basically of the dance that Jane Henderson was doing at Brooklyn Folk Festival in some of these old, I mean, these, some of these accounts, these are from the 1700s, what I'm about to read y'all. But Epstein says that both African and European dances were called jigs in the 18th century. So the term jig was interchangeable. So probably native dancing. And I think it sort of seems to just be sort of an unstructured, it can be danced solo or two people can dance together. Or a lot of times they get in a ring and there's dancers in the middle. But it's all basically called jig dancing back then. It's sort of a low class dance for lower class people, I guess. They just called it jig. But here's a description from 1788 in Jamaica of a Christmas celebration of both Africans and Europeans dancing together. And it says, their feet beating time remarkably quick. Two of them generally dance together and sometimes do not move 6 inches from the same space. And more accounts here, also from the 1700s, turning and moving about. They have no regular dances. Dancers observing the exactest precision as to time and measure. The dance consisted of stamping the feet. The whole person moved without raising the feet from the ground, etc., etc. And these are all accompanied mostly in the 1700s. It's mostly African-American slaves accompanied by drums and, in many cases, a banjo. And they're doing that same kind of, it sounds to me like what the writers are describing is very similar to that dance that Jane was doing, that flat foot dance. The feet are moving rapidly and keeping perfect precise time to the music. If you saw Jane, the way she danced, lots of heel toe taps. Every time I was hitting the banjo, a part of her feet were tapping. So it's very fast, very precise, yet the body looks like it's really loose and relaxed and almost like it's not moving and hovering around. So there's a lot of great accounts. I'm still very early in this book, but you guys ought to pick up a copy of this book if you're interested in the history of this music, because it's a little bit about banjo. A lot of it's about banjos, early banjo stuff, but it's also a lot about the singing, the dancing, you know, the social stuff that went along with the stuff that we're talking about, you know, this where this music came out of. So that's a great book, Sinful Tunes and Spirituals by Epstein. All right, so that's a bit of time on that question. I got some more questions here, but I'm going to do them in a future video here in the next day or so. So y'all will be hearing from me shortly. Thanks for watching.